Hello everyone, hi, welcome to the channel of Wall Street Mojo.
Watch the video till the end, and also if you are new to this channel, then you can subscribe us by clicking the bell icon.
Friends, today we have a topic which is anti-dilutive securities. The most important part for any company, because you know anti-dilutive securities, they reduce the earning per share. See, I have taken in call as the extract of the Colgate Palmolive company. As you can see over here, there's a two type of EPS. One is the basic EPS and another is the diluted EPS. So what exactly there's a difference? See, for the basic EPS, there's no anti-dilutive securities which results in reduction of the EPS, but in case of the dilutive EPS, they lead to the dilution of a company's earning per share. And why does that thing happen? Because they are dilutive in nature. They have an option to convert in the future. Okay, we have to get into the nitty-gritty of this topic before we make some clear conclusion at the beginning. So the basic earning per share, the BEPS of the company is always there. That has to be always higher than the DEPS, that is diluted earning per share. Let us have a look at the snapshot over here of the Colgate's EPS. We note that the diluted EPS over here, 2.38, is the diluted earning per share is more than the diluted EPS over here, 2.38, is less than the BEPS. Here it is less. Here it is less. Right. So what are the anti-dilutive securities? Well, the anti-dilutive securities are those dilutive securities that results in the higher dilutive earning per share. In such a case, we wouldn't use that security in our calculation of the diluted earning per share. So at the beginning, what I told you that, it results in reduction. No, actually anti-dilutive is the one which increases, which does not decrease, but it increases the dilutive earning per share. So that's why it is anti-dilutive. It's not dilutive, it's anti-dilutive. And let's take an example to illustrate how the anti-dilutive security works and how to treat the anti-dilutive security while calculating the diluted EPS. Let's say there is a company R that has issued a convertible bond of at $200 per share, $200 par value issued at par of the total, let's say $50,000, which is yielding, let's say 15%. Now company R has mentioned that each bond, each bond can be converted into, let's say, 20 shares into common stock. So the weighted average outstanding number of the common shares is 16,000. So the net income of the company R for the year is, let's say, standing at $20,000, and the paid preference dividend, that is PD, is, let's say, $4,000. Tax rate, let's say, amounts to 25%. So what we need to do is we need to find the basic EPS and the diluted EPS, and we need to compare the two. So in the above example, the first we will calculate is the EPS and the dilutive EPS, right? Well, the earning per share is going to be the net income. That is, the EPS is going to be the net income minus any preference dividend divided by the average number of common shares. Well, the basic EPS over here has to be, from the details, 20,000 less 4,000 divided by 16,000. So that this should be in the bracket, so it comes down to $1 per share. Now to compute the diluted EPS here, first of all we'll calculate the number of the common shares that would be converted from the convertible bond. And in this situation, for each of the convertible bond, there are 40 common shares, right, that would be issued. Now if we convert all of this convertible bond into common shares, we would get something like this, 250, as you can see over here, into 200, right, into 0.15 into 1 bracket, because it will be after tax, 1 minus 0.25, the tax it is, so post tax, that will give us 5625. So now we will calculate the diluted EPS of the company R. The diluted EPS will be net income less the net income minus the preferred dividend minus the PD, right? And what we need to add over here is the earning of the convertible bond divide by any weighted average convertible number of the common shares plus the convertible or the converted common shares from the convertible bond. So let's get down to the numbers here quickly. It's going to be 20,000 less 4,000 plus 5,625, and this will be divided by 16,000, that is the total number of shares, plus there'll be dilutive securities, that is going to be 5,000. So the total answer is going to be 1.03. So that's going to be your dilutive earning per share. Well, in the above example, what we saw that, you know, the convertible bonds, they are anti-dilutive in nature. This was basic, and diluted is coming 1.02. So this convertible shares are increasing the EPS and not decreasing. So when any increase in the EPS, it is considered not dilutive. It is considered anti-dilutive, right? So that's the call over here. When a company has anti-dilutive security like this, in this particular above example, it excludes the anti-dilutive securities from the calculation of the dilutive earning per share. Okay. Now, how to check if the convertible preferred stock is anti-dilutive security or not? So to check whether, you know, the convertible preferred stock is anti-dilutive, we need to calculate the convertible preferred dividend divided by the convertible preference shares. So if the ratio over here, this ratio is, let's say if it is less than the basic, that is BEPS, a convertible preferred stock is dilutive in nature and should be included in the calculation of the dilutive EPS. Now, if the ratio over here, this particular thing, if that is greater than the basic EPS, that is the BEPS, then the convertible preferred stock is anti-dilutive. Now, how to check over here if the convertible debt is an anti-dilutive security or not? So before calculating the dilutive EPS, one needs to check if the security is anti-dilutive not. So to check whether the convertible debt is an anti-dilutive or not, you can calculate something like this. The convertible debt interest into what we say 1 minus the tax rate divided by the convertible shares. Okay, the convertible, what we call as the debt shares. So if the ratio is over here, if the ratio, if it is less than the BEPS, the basic earning per share, the convertible debt is, as you can see, the dilutive security and should be included in the calculation of the diluted EPS. Now, if the ratio over here, if that is greater than the BEPS, then the convertible debt is dilutive. It is anti-dilutive in nature. So that's it for the anti-dilutive shares.
So that's it for this particular topic. If you have learned and enjoyed watching this video, please like and comment on this video and subscribe to our channel for the latest updates. Thank you, everyone. Cheers.